God bless you, people of God. This is Pastor Riddle, here to greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We say to you that this is a day that the Lord has made. We want to rejoice and be exceedingly glad in it. Listen, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to go and call a neighbor and call a friend and let them know that, listen, Pastor Riddle is going to be teaching the lesson tonight, especially for my dear friend and cousin, Pastor Odell McFarland III, and for the God Harbor for All Souls family. Listen, I want you to know something. That, listen, God is moving by His Spirit. He's moving by His Spirit. Well, our lesson tonight is, have thou faith, have faith in God. If you have faith in God. And this is something that we need to do more of, and that is get into the place of receiving the promises of God until there be a performance of the thing that God has promised us. It's important, people of God, that you begin to fight the good fight of faith. And not only that, but it's imperative that we learn to believe God until the word spoken has been sown into our hearts in such a way until we are walking about with an assurance that what God has promised, He's also going to perform. And that's the thing that the enemy wants to fight the saints of God over, and that is their faith in this hour. The devil doesn't want you to believe that what God has promised you is going to come to pass. He doesn't want you to believe that. So he'll throw fiery darts at you. He'll throw doubt and unbelief. And then sometimes he'll try to make situations appear worse than what they really are. He'll try to make life appear to be worse than what it really is. So you got to understand something, people of God, and that is, faith moves God. Having a confidence and an assurance in God moves Him every time, because He knows your heart when you come up before Him. He knows that you come with a full heart of assurance that, listen, He's going to fulfill His word. You saying, God, I believe that you God that will not lie. And Lord, I believe that you will keep your word. And that's the thing that the enemy wants to keep out of the heart and out of the lives of God's people. And that is the thing that moves God, the thing that pleases God. The scripture says in the book of Hebrews, without faith it's impossible to please God. He that cometh to God must believe that He is, and a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. He knows, now the enemy knows, that if you get this assurance on the inside of you, which comes by the word of God, the Bible said faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, the enemy knows that if you get this assurance and get the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of promise in your heart, he knows is he doesn't have a fighting chance of pulling you out of the presence of God. He knows that. And then he also knows that he doesn't have a fighting chance of convincing you otherwise of the promise that God has made you. He knows you're going to trust in the Lord. He knows that faith is going to posture your heart to become upright and give you an assurance and a confidence that is going to keep you striving and pressing towards the things of God until that thing that God has promised you has been brought to pass. Even if it's eternal life, faith is just that strong that it can lock you in and position you to believe, to live according to the will of God until the Lord calls you home. That's how strong faith really is. It brings a confidence. It brings an assurance. So you won't be too eager to jump off into things because you have this confidence that if I please God, He's going to reward. If I please God, He's going to bless me. If I live for Him, He's going to bless my life. He will give me eternal life. Well, this is why it's imperative that we teach this. Because why? We see that in the world today, that even in the midst of this pandemic, that death is on an all-time high. It leaves one country and it goes into another country. And look like, my God, there's chaos, there's fear, there's death, there's anxieties. All of this is happening in our world even on today. But what gives us a reassurance that God will not allow none of these plague nor diseases to come our way? And even if they did or do, He would give us the grace and the power and the wherewithal to pray, to rebuke, or to bind and to cast out of our presence. Well, when you have faith in your heart and confidence in the Lord, you will know that God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. When he opens his mouth and speak, so shall it be that goeth forth out of his mouth. Well, I have you to know that even my God, when you have confidence in the Lord, that he will begin to apply Psalms 91 over your life. I don't care where you go. I don't care who you're around. Still, the Lord will allow his angels to protect you, and he will keep you covered under his wings. Well, we want to give you a word tonight, and that is have faith in God. If you're going to have faith in God. This is what Matthew says, Matthew 11 and 22. It says, and Jesus answering said unto them, have faith in God. Even the Lord encourages us in his word to have faith in God. Have faith in God. Listen, you're to get the word of God in your heart or in your life in such a way until you're able to not only meditate upon it, but you purpose in your heart to do what you've heard. You purpose in your heart to do. What is it the word of God is saying for us to do? Believe. We're to believe. We're to believe that all things are possible to him that believe. We're to have that word of assurance that so much so until when he tells us to ask, we ask, believing we shall receive. We seek to find, and we knock for every door to come open. And this is what we do when we have an assurance that what God has promised us is going to surely come to pass. Why I need my faith? The Bible said the just shall live by faith. The Bible said we walk by faith and not by sight. There are several reasons why I need this confidence or assurance abiding on the inside, especially during these troublesome times, the times that we're living in. Because faith has to position us and lock us in on God's divine ability. I'm showing you clearly what I'm saying in the word of the Lord. I've taught this before, but I believe it's for us to go over it again. And that's Romans, the fourth chapter. I believe what happens, this is what happened to Abraham. Abraham was fully persuaded because he was in an impossible situation at that time when God made him a promise. He was facing, my God, an impossible thing that was going on even in his life. And that was being told that he was going to have a child at 100 years of age. That was an impossible thing. Even, my God, Sarah, his wife, being 90, they were told that, listen, God was going to bring forth and cause them to produce a child. Well, my God, that was an impossible thing. But yet, the word of God somehow made his way into Abraham's heart and gave him the assurance and the faith to believe that, listen, what God had promised, he was also able to perform. And it was not only was he going to bless him with a seed, but he also told him, my God, how nations shall, my God, proceed from him. That is pretty deep. How, my God, kings, princes, and kings were going to come out of, my God, his loins. Isn't that deep? That is something to think about, facing an impossible situation, but yet he had enough faith to believe that God was going to make it possible. Let me show you clearly what I'm saying in the word of the Lord. We find in, my God, in the word of the Lord, even once you start reading from the very first verse all the way down, my God, until, oh, my Lord, until it just, until complete the whole chapter. Abraham, my God, began to go through a process. And this is what happens when true faith comes into your heart. You'll be willing to go through a process in order for that promised word to, my God, be brought to pass on your behalf. And I'm love what I'm hearing here, because that is pretty something, that's something to think about. Never looked at it this way, but what causes people to separate themselves or get away from things that will hinder the word is the assurance of the word of God that was spoken. The assurance of the word of God that was spoken. And when you have that assurance of the word of God, you don't mind being ridiculed. You don't mind being talked about, persecuted, because why? You have an assurance that what God had promised you is going to surely come to pass. And this is the same like attitude and heart that Abraham had when God made him a promise. He went through the process of being, my God, circumcised, the process. He went through the process of waiting. He went through the process. He went through a process, but yet he held on to the word of promise. Yet he was fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was also able to perform. After being circumcised, then he went through the process of not only waiting, but praising and glorifying God before the promise came to pass. And that's the thing that faith will do. It will give an assurance. And not only that, but after going through that, then he went through the process of righteousness, because righteousness stems from faith. In other words, righteousness is the very thing that causes one's heart to believe. It turns one's heart from doubt and unbelief and causes one to, my God, become righteous or upright, or heart upright before the presence of the Lord. It postures your heart and it positions your heart in the sight of God correctly. And that's what God wants. He wants our hearts to be upright and upright before him, or correct before him. And our hearts has to become correct before the Lord. When your heart is correct before the Lord, it says, Lord, I believe and I trust you. I trust your word. I trust in your divine ability. I trust you. When your heart becomes upright, it turns from the negativity. It turns from, my God, the ways and the wrath of man. It turns from the opinion of men, the negative opinion of men, but it fully, solely trusts in that which has been spoken from the mouth of God. When your heart becomes upright, it has no room for unbelief. When it becomes upright, it turns from, my God, the position of that of the enemy, the persuasion of the enemy, the lies of the enemy, and it turns directly into the spirit of truth. And this is something that God wants. How many can truly say that your heart is upright before the Lord? When your heart becomes upright, did you not know there's no good thing God will withhold from you? When your heart is upright, when your heart is righteous, postured just right, my God, positioned just right before the eyes of God, because you have to understand something. Man see the outward appearance, but God sees your heart. God knows when you fully trust him. You know, it's a thing when you start speaking and you start confessing and you start allowing, it's a thing when you allow that thing to just marinate in your heart, what the word of the Lord has said, or what God has spoken to you. You start confessing it. You start meditating. You start embracing it. Don't you know God see when your heart has been, my God, when your heart has been fully wallpapered, or from wall to wall covered by the word of God, leaving no room for doubt and unbelief. The Lord knows when you've been fully persuaded. He knows. And then the Lord, what he would do out of the kindness, out of a kind act, he will walk you in an element of his goodness, and he will introduce you before the main promise. He'll allow you to experience his loving kindness. He'll allow you to experience his friendship. He'll allow you to experience certain things about him to help build the confidence. Now, you hear what I'm saying? He will help build that confidence. So, my God, when it comes time for him to deliver that word or speak a word of your future into your present, you believe him. Why? Because you reflect on his goodness. You reflect on the times he brought you out. You reflect on the times he showed you kindness. You reflect on the times that he was merciful to you. And then and you start marinating that in your heart. And then you start opening up your heart to receive the promise that he wants to bless you, or the good that he wants to show you, because he's extremely good. When the Lord said he's your redeemer, when the Lord said he's your Jehovah Jireh, your provider, when the Lord says he is your God, he wants you to fully embrace it, so much so until you witness his kindness each and every day of your life, until you witness his loving kindness, until you receive an expression from him, knowing that, listen, he's into you and he wants to bless your life. But you need that faith to keep you chasing after him in the morning time, in the noon. You need that faith that will keep you trusting in his word, that what he promised, he's going to also perform. That's what you need. So much so until you begin to glorify him, praise him, and exalt his wonderful name, giving him glory before the promise, even before it come to pass. And did you not know, when you have that type of faith, did you not know you receive the spirit of the promise? For the Bible tells us, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Oh, I wish I can go into that more. But did you not know you can receive the spirit of the spirit of promise on your life? not only the spirit that God promised to give as a result of believing on him, but there's also the spirit of promise that will rest on your life to let you know that what God has said is going to surely come to pass. The spirit that will also remind you of the word of promise that God has made you. That's what the saints need at all times. And that's the spirit of promise resting on their lives to remind them that, listen, what God said, he's going to surely bring it to pass. And not only that, but he can do it. He has the power and the wherewithal. He has the kingdom to bring every promised word that he made you to pass. And that's the thing that God wants us to operate in this time and in this season. Listen, don't be weary in your well-doing. Don't be weary in your seek. Don't be weary in your press. Don't be weary in studying the word of God. Don't be weary in hoping. Don't be weary. Don't be weary in the things of God. Because trust me, after he mowed and made you and prepped you for where he's about to take you, then when he see that you're ready, he'll release that promise into your life. And I believe we're in a season and in a time that God is going to do just that. Start opening up doors or the windows of heaven and start pouring out blessings that you won't have room enough to receive. I believe from my heart that blessings are going to start overtaking the people of God in this time and in this season. You say, well, Pastor Riddle, we're still on the brink of coming through a pandemic. It doesn't matter. It lets you know that, listen, if you're still alive and God has kept you, that means he has a promise that he wants to fulfill. The only reason why death, my God, couldn't take the children of Israel out when it came in the land is because why? God had a promised land waiting for them. That's the only reason why. And the scripture says, well, I see the blood, I'll pass over. And this is why God didn't allow death to take you out. It's because he made your promise. And this is why you're still here, because God made your promise. And this is our lesson on tonight. Get the faith of God. Well, let me try to give you maybe a verse of scripture to talk about Abraham. In the 13th verse, it said, for the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Through the righteousness of faith. For if they which are of the law be heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of none effect. But the law worketh wrath, for where no law is, there is no transgression. But look what the word of the Lord said in the 16th verse. Therefore it is of faith, that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope that he might be become the father of many nations according to that which was spoken. So shall thy seed be. Look at the word of the Lord. Listen, and being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. And in other words, oh, that is wonderful. Look at Abraham as our example. But you have to understand something. He hung in there. Irregardless to how bad it looked, irregardless to how time had passed him by, and when some would have considered to be my God, through and dead, he said, listen, I'm going to still believe God. And that's how the Lord wants us to come to him. That's what he wants us to do, is still believe God. Well, this is Pastor Riddle. All my time is out, and I want you to listen. Know that I appreciate God, Abba, for all souls. I want you to know that, listen, we're still joining in on one accord, supporting one another. And listen, all those that are working in the gospel and the ministry with Pastor O, God bless each and every one of you for your faithfulness. Remain faithful to the call and work of the Lord. Well, until next time, this is Pastor Riddle saying, you go with God and he shall
go with you. Remember now, faith moves God. Have faith in God. That's what God wants us to do. And that is have faith in God. Until next time, take care. Bye-bye.